On a routine cross-country flight, an experienced pilot made a series of decisions that turned a smooth journey into one of sheer terror.
6-7, no go. We're in a mayday, mayday, mayday.
6-7, Delta Jax, can you hear me now?
He said he was upside down.
I got you.
What happened to November 4467 Delta? As we investigate, ask yourself honestly, what would I have done differently? The question may not be so easy to answer. It's just before 10 a.m. on Wednesday, July 8th, 2009, and the summer heat is already stifling in McKinney, Texas. A company-owned Cessna Golden Eagle 421C taxis to the runway at Collin County Regional Airport. The destination? Tampa, Florida. On board are five close friends and colleagues, the company president, the commercially rated company pilot, another employee, and two others. While the primary purpose is business, a trade show in Tampa, this flight is also about friendship and celebration, with plans to mark one passenger's birthday. While most of the flight is expected to be smooth, the thunderstorm stretching from the Gulf eastward poses serious concern for the pilot. When filing his IFR flight plan that morning, he informed the briefer of his intent to deviate around the weather. With nearly 2,000 hours of flight time under his belt, he is confident in his ability to navigate the challenges ahead. Also, 4467 Delta is no ordinary Cessna. It's been upgraded with winglets, spoilers, vortex generators, and high-performance engines. The pressurized twin almost seems like a mini airliner. The advanced onboard weather tools, radar, storm scope, and an XM weather satellite receiver are precisely what the pilot needs to see and avoid any convective activity. The first 2 hours of the flight pass uneventfully. At 1:15 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, Jacksonville Center reroutes 67 Delta just before they enter the Florida Panhandle to avoid active military airspace. Becoming concerned with the widespread storms ahead, the pilot informs Jack Center about his deviation plans.
We're looking at the weather here over Heaven intersection. Doesn't look too good. We might be going a little bit further east and see if we can go around this.
That shouldn't be a problem. I do see folks going through there. I'm showing actually the more extreme precip over closer to Apalachicola than Heaven. But as you're getting closer, just let us know what you need.
What the controller doesn't mention is that the extreme weather over Apalachicola is steadily moving eastward, right into 67 Delta's flight path. After another reroute for active military operations at 1:39 p.m., Jack Center issues an additional weather alert.
Depict a line of moderate, heavy to extreme precipitation. Begins at your 11 o'clock and 40 miles, extending southeast bound. We're going to be unable any right deviations due to active MOAs, so if you want to deviate to the left, let me know.
The workload is starting to build for the single pilot. 15 minutes later, 67 Delta requests any pilot reports from ATC. Their XM weather radar shows severe storm cells over the Heaven intersection along their arrival route.
I am painting a bunch of moderate to heavy precipitation. It starts about 35 to 45 southeast of Seminole and extends all the way to about 30 north of Tampa. The aircraft are able to deviate and get through it. Right now, it's a smooth ride going through the area. The next sectors have been able to get the aircraft through a couple of small holes down that way, north of Tampa.
Roger that, because it looks like we're picking up on XM weather near Heaven that's pretty orange, almost red in that area.
I agree. You can expect an east deviation around Heaven.
Roger that. 67 Delta.
Even though the reports are from airliners many times the size of 67 Delta, the success stories are encouraging. At 2:01 p.m., Jack Center clears 67 Delta direct to the Tabor intersection, a fix on the published arrival, and permits them to deviate as needed. The pilot alters course eastward to avoid an area of moderate precipitation. But it's becoming apparent that if they continue their present course to Tampa, it will be nearly impossible to avoid these buildups. About a minute and a half later, ATC checks in.
And 67 Delta, I did tell you about all the precip you got to deal with here in the next 30 miles to about 30 north of Tampa.
Roger that. Yeah, we're still showing it here on the XM weather. And for 67 Delta, you were saying it's a fairly smooth ride going through it?
Yes, sir. They've all been air carriers so far going through, but they've all said smooth ride and some light rime icing at flight level 190.
Roger that. 67 Delta, thank you.
Shortly after this exchange, the controller briefs their colleague on the arrival flows. To deal with the weather, they've been routing traffic east of that area, which has been working, so far. At 2:08 p.m., Jack Center broadcasts that several convective SIGMETs are now active. Areas of thunderstorms are moving east at 25 knots, with tops reaching flight level 450, indicating strong convective action. Two of these SIGMETs cover 67 Delta's route of flight and destination. At this point, the airplane is right on the edge of the largest convective area. The pilot must make a choice: avoid the weather and divert, or proceed. If the pilot decides to proceed, he will be unable to visually avoid storms. Instead, he will have to depend on onboard weather equipment. The pilot of 4467 Delta presses onward. At 2:11 p.m., ATC instructs the airplane to descend to 17,000 feet. The pilot reports a smooth ride and light rime icing, just as expected from the PIREPS, before requesting a further descent to 15,000 feet. 16 minutes later, 67 Delta requests a deviation around an area of moderate precipitation.
Number 67 Delta, Jacksonville Center, scattered, moderate, isolated, extreme precip between you and Tampa. Let me know what kind of headings you're going to need, please.
And for 67 Delta, can we get a right of course, probably heading 200?
67 Delta, that's approved.
At 2:41, ATC clears the aircraft lower in preparation for getting them back on the published arrival.
Number 67 Delta, cross 1515 north of Darbs at 5,000.
Yeah, roger that. 15 north of Darbs at 5,000, 67 Delta.
At this point, 67 Delta is just over 50 miles from Tampa, and up to now, the flight has gone smoothly. But 5 minutes later, the pilot alerts ATC of a serious issue.
And Center 67 Delta, we're in quite a bit of turbulence. Is there any chance of you can give us some direction?
On their radar, the controller sees the aircraft right at the edge of the precipitation and heading for clear air.
67 Delta, looks like straight ahead is the best way out there.
Not straight ahead for about 2 minutes.
Point out. Clear at all on the south side.
13 seconds pass before the pilot transmits more troubling news. He is losing control of the airplane.
67 Delta, we're getting a 2,000 foot descent here.
67 Delta, would you like to turn around and go opposite direction, turn around and go back to where you came from?
Yes, sir.
67 Delta, roger, reverse course.
Jack Center's radar shows 67 Delta attempting a right turn before suddenly transmitting a plea for help.
67 Delta, we're in a mayday, mayday, mayday. We're upside down. My God, hurry.
Seconds later, ATC loses radar contact with the airplane, and no further radio transmissions from them are heard.
Center, you better scramble whatever you scramble, because I think they hit the ground.
We're going, sir.
Investigators soon discovered two distinct debris fields in the Gulf of Mexico, indicating an in-flight breakup around 6,000 feet. There were no survivors. This was a clear sign that the aircraft had encountered forces far beyond its design limits. Now, investigators needed to determine how and why this happened. A review of the radar data answered how. During the right turn to escape the situation, the pilot inadvertently entered a storm cell of extreme intensity. Satellite data revealed that the area contained rapidly growing cumulonimbus clouds in their mature stage, the most powerful and dangerous phase of a thunderstorm. With the clarity of hindsight, it's easy to state the obvious. A Cessna 421 should never have been near such powerful storms. But why did the pilot get into this deadly situation? Six-7 Delta was equipped with advanced weather tools. However, these tools have limitations, limitations that may have led the pilot straight into the heart of the storm. First, let's look at the onboard weather radar. Weather radar allows pilots to see areas of precipitation in real time, color-coded by intensity. However, the device can be tricky to use correctly. One limitation is called precipitation attenuation. In heavy rain, the radar beam weakens as it travels through the storm, making the precipitation look lighter than it is. Very dense cells can create a radar shadow, a blind spot that hides the weather beyond it. This could easily lead a pilot to believe they're flying into a manageable situation, only to be met with the full force of the storm. Distance attenuation further complicates things. Weather radar on board smaller aircraft is most effective within 40 to 80 nautical miles. Beyond this range, the radar's accuracy diminishes, giving a false sense of security about what lies ahead. Then there's the challenge of adjusting the radar tilt. Tilt is the radar's angle above or below the horizon. Incorrect tilt settings can make storms appear weaker or farther away than they are. For a single pilot flying IFR, managing this while under a heavy workload is a lot to handle. Now, we can't say whether the pilot of 67 Delta was using the weather radar correctly or at all. His transmissions only mention the use of XM satellite weather radar. And XM radar has its own limitations, most notably a delay of up to 15 minutes in the data. This means the storm you see on the screen could have already moved or intensified. And just like the conventional radar on board November 4467 Delta, XM is unable to accurately detect turbulence. So, what if the pilot's XM radar data was 15 minutes old when he began encountering severe turbulence? Here's what he would have seen. A cell with moderate to heavy precipitation straight ahead with a gap to the right. Perhaps he thought he was entering the cell to his left and needed to change course to the right. But the actual conditions, as seen here, were much different. The clearest area was straight ahead, with heavy echoes to the left and right. What might have looked like a gap to the pilot was actually a mature storm cell. Beyond the technical limitations, human factors played an equally important role. Expectation bias may have influenced the pilot's decisions. Other aircraft, large airliners, were successfully navigating the storms. Despite being a high-performance twin, 67 Delta wasn't an airliner. Big jets can stem more extreme forces and get through bad weather quicker. Also, as the storm worsened, ATC first suggested continuing straight ahead. That was the correct choice. But then they commanded a course reversal, a well-intentioned recommendation, but one that may have sealed the aircraft's fate. The NTSB concluded that the accident was caused by the pilot's decision to operate into a known area of adverse weather, leading to the inadvertent penetration of a severe thunderstorm, a subsequent loss of control, and in-flight breakup. As aviators, we must know when to trust our instruments, when to question them, and when to turn back. The pressure to keep going is always there, but resisting it can be the most important decision we make. Fly safely, and thanks for watching.